I'm really very happy seeing so many young people like the way Mr. Henry Defense felt happy that so many young people are here listening to speakers on human rights. A few days back I was traveling on a flight. I had a fellow passenger, a boy, must be 12, 13 years of age. He was, the moment the flight took off, he started munching chocolates. Started eating for hours together, and I felt so curious. I asked him. I thought whether I should talk to him because he was a stranger, but still the way he was consuming chocolates, I thought it was my duty to stop him. So I intervened and I asked him, is it good for you to eat so much of chocolates? Friends, you know what he answered? He said, my grandfather lived for 105 years. So, stop. What did I ask? I asked him about chocolates and he is talking about his grandfather. I thought that, okay, maybe he is relating chocolates with his grandfather. I asked him, your grandfather lived for 105 years by eating chocolates? You know what answer he said? He said, no, not by eating chocolates, he was minding his own business. Instead of minding your own business, you guys have risked your life in coming and sitting inside this auditorium to listen to these speeches on human rights and especially who should be protected. Now, as a law teacher, the answer to this question, according to me, is who should be protected? Human rights should be protected. Because the current state of human rights in this country requires protection. Human rights is in the ICU. It has to be protected. I'm just going to into an academic discourse on how human rights is defined in this country. There is a law called Protection of Human Rights Act, made in the year 1993, 25-year-old law. It has a section which defines human rights. Interestingly, Indian legislation has a definition of human rights, which no other country did. We tried to be different, wanted to define human rights. And why do we define things? What is the meaning of definition? Definition is to explain, to clarify, to make it simple, so that people understand. Am I not right? That's why we define things, to make things easy to understand, to make it clear. But the way human rights is defined in the Indian law, it has to be protected. That is why I thought that if we are going to do some justice to human rights, this definition needs to be changed immediately. If the thought that this is a parliament, let's talk about certain amendments that we can bring into the law. If at all we need to talk about changing something on human rights, let's change the definition of human rights. How it is defined? Nobody understands. When I started teaching this subject, the definition says like this. I went to the class, I said, dear students, human rights is This is what section 2.1b of the Protection of Human Rights Act says. Human rights means rights relating to life, rights relating to liberty, rights relating to equality, rights relating to dignity. And they did not leave it at that level. They further complicated it by adding two more phrases to it. Number one, guaranteed by the Constitution of India. Number two, are embodied in international covenants which must be enforceable by the courts in India. Friends, I do not know how many of you are from the law faculty here. Even there are, in fact, I'll tell you, when I encountered this problem in the classroom of not able to explain this definition, to convince my own students on the definition of this human rights, then I had a discussion with Mr. Hendry at his office in People's Watch. He said, this is a wonderful thing, Professor, you should in fact do the research and write a book on it, and you go ahead, I will publish that book. I did it. So when I started exploring the definition, it took, of course, few years to find out the real meaning of this definition of human rights. It came around 200 pages. To understand what human rights means for me as a researcher, as a law teacher, I just did a study, a random study, by sending a questionnaire to many lawyer friends in the country. I sent them this definition and I asked them a few questions. Like, how many of you understand clearly what is human rights? By this definition, what is given in the Protection of Human Rights Act. Believe me, it was hardly 38% of the lawyers said that they are able to understand what human rights means. 38%. Remaining 62% of the lawyers confessed that they were not clear with what this definition conveys. This was after my first question. Then I further wanted to explain or understand how even these 38% of them really understood this definition. Again, sent a questionnaire asking them, like, for example, there was a question like, under what conditions international covenants are enforceable by courts in India? Friends, this is a topic where PhD scholars are writing a thesis on it. And this is a part of our definition. And believe me, after that study, less than 6%, it was 5.84% of the population that I surveyed, said that they could understand the definition of human rights. And this is the current status of human rights. They have not defined it. Very ambiguously, rights related to life. If it would have been a small classroom, I would have interacted with you, I would have asked you these questions to find out how many of you are able to answer this question. What is right to life? Itself is ambiguous. And if we say rights relating to life, what are those rights relating to life? So it gives a lot of scope and freedom for the courts to interpret. I'm happy. That way, in the 80s, we had wonderful judges like Justice Krishna Iyer and Justice Bhagwati who gave a progressive interpretation to these words. They brought in almost everything under these rights. Right to liberty means this, 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 this. What all Mr. Hendry told. For example, right to livelihood, right to shelter, they brought everything, right to road, right to education. Everything they brought under the definition of right to life. But what we have done is, instead of giving the common man a list of rights, what has been done in the Universal Declaration or in the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, the international community did not attempt to come up with a two-line definition. The UNESCO, before preparing the draft for the UDHR, Universal Declaration of Human Rights, in 1948, it came out with a document expressing its difficulty in coming up with a comprehensive definition for human rights. It said, in fact, it avoided defining the word human rights, and rather it came out with a list of rights so that people can know from this list whether you have a right, and then you can start enforcing it. For example, if you want to know, young people, if you have a right to marry, is it a human right? Yes, international government says right to marry is a human right. But now, from our definition, if you will be able to understand whether this right is a human right or not, you will not, because there is no comprehensive list attached to this in the legislation. This results to the failure of this legislation, because we have certain examples. I know of a case filed in one of the human rights courts in Tamil Nadu. It's called Tamil Nadu Palangudi Sangam. It's a case filed by the Tribals Association. Right? When they filed a human rights petition before the human rights court under the section 30 of the Protection of Human Rights Act, the judge, instead of accepting that petition, admitting that petition and sending the summons, he returned that petition with all these queries. What do you mean by human rights? What do you mean by human rights violations? What do you mean, which are those offenses which are called human rights offenses? And what is the punishment prescribed? Whether this offense is a cognizable offense, non-cognizable offense. Right, the guy who filed this petition went crazy. If a judge is asking me all these questions, even without admitting this case, what will I do? Then he went to, through some contacts, through some organization, he approached Justice Krishna Iyer for help. And Justice Krishna Iyer wrote a letter to the Chief Justice of Madras High Court, stating that this is the condition of the judges. They don't understand what is human rights violations. What are human rights offenses? Why don't you constitute a bench? So the Chief Justice of the Madras High Court had to constitute a bench of judges to define all these things. Again, explain. Again, there is another 212 judgment explaining all those things. So this situation, if human rights is not defined properly, if it is not listed clearly, if it is not enumerated and given to you in a manner in which you can understand, these kind of exploitations will continue. For example, right to work in appropriate labor standards has been declared by the Supreme Court as a human right, as a fundamental right, and a right to life, Article 21. But Human Rights Commission, you just look into the National NHRC's website, where they say that the petitions which we will not entertain, they say labor disputes we will not entertain. If there is a discrimination happening in a workplace, you can't go to NHRC. The NHRC will simply brand it as a labor dispute. So this is the current state of affairs as far as human rights is concerned in this country. And this is precisely the reason I thought I should use this parliament to propose this change, to propose this motion, that if at all something has to be protected, the definition of human rights has to be protected in this country. And this definition needs to be changed. And this is an immediate prayer. I know when I went for a class to learn about public speaking, so I am reminded of what my guru told me, that if you want your speakers to like you, speak very little for 10 minutes. If you want them to love you, shut up and go and sit back. Thank you so much. I want all of you to love me. Thank you.
after deliberating.